Now, I'm not a big math person, but I do understand quite a lot about statistics, and I actually like statistics. Statistics makes a lot of sense, even for a person like me who's not really into math. But this is where single subject research is kind of a disappointment. There are no real statistics for single subject research. I mean, there are methods that we use to display the data and analyze the data, but it's nothing like the other kinds of research we've talked about. Because when it comes to single subject research, the way we analyze the data is by using visual inspection, which is a very sciencey term. It's a very technical sounding term, which basically means you'll look at it. Like, I'm serious. I'm dead serious. When it comes to single subject research, the standard way of analyzing what's happening here is to look at the data. And generally, the way we do that is by plotting individual participants' data throughout their, you know, multiple tests, throughout their multiple observations. So we look at the data over these observations, and we carefully compare the different data points, and based on how the data is changing over time, we'll make decisions. Like, we'll make decisions such as, does the treatment we applied seem to be working, or do they seem to be getting better at some task, you know, whatever it is that we might be studying. We simply look at the data and make those kinds of decisions. There are no real inferential statistics for this. Here's an example. So you can see with this particular data set, we have 8 days where we're going to observe the performance of our single subject. And as you can see, it's not changing all that much. And then we apply some kind of treatment and suddenly their performance goes way up. If this is what your data looks like, if you were a single subject researcher and you collected that kind of data, that would seem pretty convincing that the treatment seems to have an effect. You know, if you just take another look at it, not much is happening, it's pretty flat, suddenly it shoots up and it stays up. So clearly it seems the treatment had something to do with it. Here's another way to look at it. You could just average the before treatments measurements and the after treatment measurements to get this kind of comparison. This very clearly shows there's a pretty big difference. But whenever you simplify data like this, whenever you use statistics instead of the raw data, you're always going to be losing something here. So just in general, you want to try to avoid simplifying your data if possible. Now, what we were just looking at there was a change in what's called a level. That's the whole point of a single subject design, is try to identify levels, or in some cases, trends. So a level is just exactly what it sounds like. It's when the data form a nice flat line. It's never going to be perfect, but if it's a consistent level, that's when the measurements are all approximately the same magnitude. And a trend then would be when it's forming a nice straight line, but now that line isn't perfectly horizontal. Now it's actually kind of slanted. It's a diagonal line. So you can have data that trend upwards, you can have data that trend downwards, but that's the only difference between trends and levels, is whether it's horizontal or diagonal. Now, there are some important terms that we use when it comes to talking about, you know, how consistent these levels and trends are. And one of those terms is stability. The degree to which the observations show a pattern of consistent level or consistent trend. So you could say the data is stable, even if it does show minor variations from this perfectly consistent pattern. But we would say it's stable if those variations are relatively small, and you can still draw a nice straight line through them. So yeah, this isn't perfect, but that's fairly stable. We would probably agree that that's stable. Whereas if you get data that looks more like this, now that doesn't seem nearly as stable. So as I was saying before, this is kind of a big disappointment for a guy like me, because we don't really have any technical way, any statistical way to determine how stable the data is. We just look at it and we make a decision. Does that look stable enough to you? If not, then we'll have to, you know, maybe change the experimental design or something like that. Now, there are three patterns of results that you could get when doing single subject research. You could get a level, like I was talking about before. So this is what you might consider a stable level. Or you could get a stable trend that could look something like this. But then, of course, there's always the possibility that you might get unstable data. And with unstable data, it's impossible to know if it's a trend or a level because it's unstable. You don't know which direction it's going. So those are the three basic results you could get. And if your data does seem to be unstable, there are a few things you could do about it. The most standard technique when dealing with unstable data is to just wait. You know, if you collect, imagine you collect 5 observations and the data is going up and down, well, just collect more. You know, maybe instead of 5, you should collect 10. Maybe over the span of 10 observations, you'll start to get something that's flattening out into a level. Maybe. So over a long enough time period, behavior trends do tend to level out. You know, they do tend to become fairly stable. Another method you can use for dealing with unstable data is to do something that I already kind of said was not a good idea, and that is averaging it out. You know, when you look at all these individual data points and they're going up and down, that doesn't look very nice. But if you just average them together and, you know, present the average, you're kind of ignoring that instability. So you're kind of brushing that instability under the rug, so to say. But that is something that researchers do for justifiable reasons. Another thing that you could do, and maybe the best idea, is to look for patterns in this inconsistency. Maybe there's a reason why the data is going up and down. Maybe you could discover something new, something interesting, something nobody expected, by looking at that pattern of instability. So that's stability. Another important term is latency, which refers to the time it takes for the dependent variable to begin changing after you make some kind of change in the conditions. So here's a demonstration of what I mean by latency. We have a dependent variable down here. We manipulate an independent variable, and then it moves. So obviously, cause and effect don't happen one right after the other. There's some kind of delay between the two. And when it comes to single subject research, that delay can be a big problem. That delay can make it very hard to actually make that cause-effect kind of link between the variables. Just in general, if a change in the dependent variable begins shortly after the independent variable, then this will be pretty clear evidence that they're linked. But if the change is not immediate, if the change happens much later, it's just going to be harder to make that connection. So, whenever you're doing this kind of visual inspection and you're looking for these stable levels and trends and you're trying to judge things like latency, there are a few different techniques you can use. There's 4 characteristics you should look for when doing a visual inspection. The first one is potential changes in the average level. So if the average level of one phase in your experiment is different from another phase in your experiment, then that might indicate something interesting is happening. Another thing you should look for is any kind of immediate changes in level. So if you see the data dramatically shift, like you have one level in one phase and then it dramatically shifts, like big time, then that would indicate that maybe you've found something interesting. So if the last data point of one phase is dramatically different from the first data point in the next phase, this would indicate some kind of effect. The third thing you should look for is changes in trend. So even if you don't really have any reason to believe that data should be trending, if you're expecting to find levels, you should still look for potential changes in trend. And if the trend of one phase is noticeably different from the trend of another phase, this clearly would be indicating that something is influencing the participant in a new way. And then the fourth thing you want to look for is latency. As I already mentioned, it's hard to identify cause-effect if there's high latency, but if you carefully inspect the data, you might be able to account for that. You know, if the change does not occur right away, you might still be able to make that connection, though it will be less convincing. So those are some basic things you want to look for, and I wanted to give you just a few examples of these kinds of things. So if you do a quick visual inspection of this data, it doesn't really seem like the treatment had much of an effect. You know, it seems like we just have this upward trend. But if I average together the before treatment observations and I average together the after treatment observations, and I compare those averages, now it does seem to make a pretty big, you know, effect. That treatment definitely does seem to be doing something now. As I already said a few times, you always need to be careful when you're doing this kind of averaging because you're losing sight of the bigger picture, but maybe you have a justifiable reason to do it this way. So that change in average, while not immediate, is in fact very large. And when you do this kind of averaging, it definitely does seem to be substantial. It seems to be like the treatment is actually having an influence. Here's another example. So this is an example of that immediate change I mentioned, that you kind of thing you should look for. So this is very easy to see. If we just look at the two data points, the last observation for the pre-phase and the first observation of the post-phase, observations 4 and 5, there's a huge difference there. So that the size of that difference, the size of that immediate change, is a very compelling piece of evidence regarding the effectiveness of your treatment. And then then the next example I'd like to show you is changes in trend. Like, if you just look at this data, it looks like it's a level. It doesn't really seem like anything's happening here. You could just draw a straight line through all the data points. But if you look at the potential trends in the pre-treatment phase, and you compare that to potential trends in the post-treatment phase, you'll see that it was actually trending upwards before the treatment, and now it's trending downwards. So this change in direction could be indicative of a treatment effect of some kind. Like, maybe the treatment isn't having a huge, massive, immediate impact, but it is making things better over time. And then the final example I wanted to show you is an example of latency, the problem of latency. So when you look at this data, it really doesn't seem like the treatment's doing anything. If you have reason to believe that your treatment does have a delayed effect, like maybe it's some kind of medicine that takes a while to really kick in, then you could argue that this is compelling evidence. But just in general, when there's such a gap between the treatment and signs of, you know, its influence, it's just hard to argue. Because no changes occur until just like 2 observations after the treatment, it's just hard to argue that the treatment is having any effect at all. But like I said, you know, you might have a justifiable reason why there is such a latency in your data.